Good afternoon, and welcome to this session of the Kween's Roundtable. I'm Evangelist Prophetess Valarie Ammons, and I am so glad that you've chosen to break bread with me today. And without further ado, we're going to go to the throne. Almighty God, in your precious Son, Jesus' name, if and when I said something that I misrepresented you, God, I repent right now in Jesus' name. God, I praise and thank you for what you're doing and what you've done and what you're going to do. God, you are amazing, loving and kind and generous, and you love us unconditionally. God, I lift up UPTV. And I thank you, God, for this platform that your word can be given out. God, I praise and thank you for loving me unconditionally and never leaving me or forsaking me. In Jesus' name, amen. And again, welcome to the Kween's Roundtable. I have some interesting information today. And as usual, I was, you know, kind of like rocking back and forth about what I was going to talk about today. So God had told me, he said, I want you to talk about misinterpretations. Misinterpretations and myths that are in the Bible. And so I said, oh, okay, God. He says, it's the three I want you to talk about, but we're going to talk about the one about the number one. The first one we're going to talk about is women speaking in church. And let's just use Genesis 5, 1 and 2. And it says, God created male and female, and he created them at the same time. That's what it says in Genesis 5 and 1. And I was paraphrasing. And we were talking about, it's in 1 Corinthians where Paul is talking about women not supposed to speak in the church. And actually it was coming from misorganization of the meeting time is what I read, that it was talking about. That's why women couldn't speak in church, because a lot of problems has started from gossip. And Paul said women don't speak in church. Now let's put that in the proper perspective. Paul is not Jesus, and so Jesus did not say that. That was Paul talking to try to remedy. Now remember, Paul was an apostle, and what he does, he sets up churches, and he tries to steer churches in the right direction. So he was trying to keep confusion down. But that's Paul talking. That is not Jesus. That is not God. God did not say women could not speak in church, because it, as it simply says in Genesis 5, 1 and 2, that God created man and woman, and he created them, male and female, and it says at the same time. So then later on it says that God created Adam first, and then he took from his rib, took a rib out and made Eve. Now, Let me say this. I don't know everything about the Bible, and some of the things in it I might not understand totally. But if you would like to put some input in and we can put our heads together and do some research, I would welcome that. Knowledge is a terrible thing to waste, and I want to get accurate information. So God has no respect of person. There have been women speaking. God has been using women all through the Bible. Anna, the prophetess, she was the first person to say that Jesus was the Messiah. Mary, she was the one who went and told them that Jesus had risen. So God has no respect of person. He will use whomever he likes, whomever he chooses to get his word out, to get people a word, to give people peace. So I would never, ever look at that scripture again and take it for face value and don't do any research, because Pastor Jones used to always say, don't just take that scripture. You got to read much more scriptures and you got to cross-reference. And so that's what I did with that. And that's when I came up, I believe it's 1 Corinthians 10 and 12. And I'm sorry, I don't have that written down right here, but I do believe I have it in my phone here, and I will look that up and get it back to and get back to you with the correct scripture where Paul is talking about to the church of Corinth about the women not speaking in church. And as I said before, this is Paul talking. There was a reason that he said that. This is not Jesus talking. Okay? So we can't take what Paul said and say that women can't speak in church, because Paul was a man, was a human being just like you and I. So that was not Jesus talking. That was one of the misinterpretations. The other misinterpretation is about the Christmas tree. Okay, I researched the Christmas tree because for years I've been hearing you go and get a Christmas tree God don't even want you to use a Christmas tree because you don't cross-reference and you don't read the whole thing. You just go what somebody tell you and you run with it. I've done it before, you know, and I have checked myself not to do it again. Okay, you just can't take what people say for face value. You have got to research it. So they were talking about Jeremiah 10, and it goes to the through the 16th verse here. And I'm going to start with the first one. And I'm going to read this to you because it's quite interesting. Because in this book, it's talking about idols. It has nothing to do with a Christmas tree on Christmas. We all understand that Christmas is not the 25th of December, just like that picture of Jesus is that people have up in all of their churches of the white man with the blue eyes and the long brown hair or blonde hair. That is not Jesus. We understand that. It's not the picture that we're worshiping at all. It is the things that Jesus did for us. We all know that that is not Jesus. And it is just a picture. To me, it should have never been put up, because then it gives people the interpretation, another misinterpretation, that Jesus is white. And just by demographics alone, he was born in Bethlehem, and it's hot as it can be. So no one's going to stay white down there because the sun's going to bake them. So just by that alone, Jesus was a man of color. Just like we all are, people of color, Jesus was a man of color. I do believe that picture up there was a way, the picture of the white Jesus was a way of keeping black people enslaved. But I will not allow it to enslave my heart. I will not allow it. The picture that depicts Jesus, I would not allow that to enslave my spirit, because I'm going to research and I'm going to find out. But it's what I feel in my heart for Jesus, for God, for the Holy Ghost. It's what I feel in my heart. So let's talk about the Christmas tree. Now, of course, my phone went back. So it says here, we're starting in Jeremiah 10th chapter. And it says, the first verse, hear what the Lord says to you, people of Israel. This is what the Lord says. Do not learn the ways of the nations or be terrified by signs in the heavens, though the nations are terrified by them. For the practices of the people are worthless. They cut a tree out of the forest, and a craftsman shapes it with his chisel. They adorn it with silver and gold. They fasten it with a hammer and nails so it will not totter. Like a scarecrow in a cucumber field, their idols cannot speak. They must be carried because they cannot walk. They do not fear them. They can do no harm, nor can they do any good. No one is like you, Lord. You are great, and your name is mighty in power. Who should not fear you? King of the nation, this is your due. Among all the wise leaders of the nations and in all their kingdoms, there is no one like you. They are all senseless and foolish and are taught by worthless wooden idols. Hammered silver is brought from Tarshish and gold from Upaz. What the craftsmen and the goldsmith have made is then dressed in blue and purple, all made by skilled workers. But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God, the eternal King. When he is angry, the earth trembles. The nations cannot endure his wrath. Tell them this, these gods who did not make the heavens and the earth will perish from earth and from under the heavens. Now, what God is saying in those chapters is North Kingdom already is in exile, and explain the foolishness of idols. Israel was not supposed to learn the ways of idolatry practiced by the nations around her, nor was she to be terrified by signs in the sky. These signs were not likely unusual occurrences such as eclipse. I'm sorry. These signs were most likely unusual occurrences such as eclipses or comets, which was thought to be signs of coming events given by the gods. Such idolatrous practices were worthless because the gods being honored were created by the worshipers. A person would chop down a tree, give the wood to a craftsman who fashioned it in the desired shape of their god, then covered it with silver and gold and fastened it to a base so that it would not totter. Once the god was made by this god was made by man, it had to be carried to its destination. It was as lifeless as a scarecrow in a melon patch. Certainly such a god could not speak to impart knowledge to his followers. So God exhorted his people not to fear these false idols. The idols had no power to harm those who disregarded them, or power to do any good for those who followed them. And it says, a blacksmith works his tools and forges metal over the coals. He forms it with hammers. He makes it with his strong arm. He gets hungry and loses his energy. He drinks no water and gets tired. A carpenter takes measurements. He marks out an outline of his form. He scraps it with his chisel and marks it with a compass. He patterns it after a man, like a well-built man, and puts it in a shrine. He cuts down cedars and acquires a cypress or an oak. He gets trees from the forest. He plants a cedar, and the rain makes it grow. A man uses it to make fire. He takes some of it and warms himself. Yes, he kindles the fires and bakes bread. Then he makes a god and worships it. He makes an idol and bows down to it. Half of it he burns in fire. Over the other half, he eats meat. He roasts a meal and fills himself. Yes, he warms himself and says, ah, I am warm as I look at the fire. With the rest of it, he makes a god, his idol. He bows down to it and worships it. He prays to it, saying, rescue me from, for you are my God. They do not comprehend their gods or understand, for their eyes are blind and cannot see. Their minds do not discern. No one thinks to himself, nor do they comprehend or understand and say to themselves, I burned half of the fire. Yes, I baked bread over the coals. I roasted meat and ate it. With the rest of this, should I make a disgusting idol? Should I bow down to dry wood? What this is saying is, this is not a Christmas tree. Christmas trees don't have eyes. Christmas trees don't have ears. It says that they can't hear and they can't see. That's a totem pole. That was the idol that the people made back in those days. A misinterpretation that have people thinking God doesn't want a Christmas tree up. That is totally not true. That is totally not true. Go back and read the scriptures. Read the scripture, Isaiah 40 and 1 through 14, I believe it is. And it talks about that, it talks about the same thing, that they can't, they have eyes and they can't see. So, I'm sorry, it's Isaiah 44, 12 through 28. This is the cross-reference scripture that says the same things. It's talking about a totem pole. It is not talking about a Christmas tree. But we take one scripture and we run with it. We don't go back to see, ah, does this what this really means? Because like I've said before, when the Bible was written, it was written using the Hebrew language, and this is English, and some words mean totally different from the Hebrew language and the English language. So we really need to research. I had someone tell me, show me Jesus really exists. No one can even find a grave. Well, he doesn't need a grave. He's risen. There isn't a grave. He was never in a grave. He was in a tomb. So don't let misinterpretations lead you away from God. Never allow anybody to lead you away from God. Think for yourself. Look for yourself. Research for yourself. Your relationship with God is your relationship with God. Don't be teeter-tottering like the toy that goes up and down, the teeter-totter. Don't teeter-totter. Stay with God. Ask God to give you a discerning spirit, because it says in the Word that the Bible was written by people who were given a discerning spirit by the Holy Ghost. It was written by people that was given the discerning spirit by the Holy Ghost. And I know that there are some scriptures in there. I don't understand all of them. I'm not going to say I do, because there's also other scriptures in the Bible that tells you, lean not to your understanding. Your ways not like my ways. That's God talking to us. So we will never understand all of the things that's in the Bible unless we ask God to give us a discerning spirit so we can understand. But do not let these misinterpretations, especially the one, women, where it says that we can't speak in church. And if you look at it, my grandmother, God rest her soul, may she rest in heaven. She was a remarkable woman. And she used to tell me, ain't no woman. And when I told her that God had called me, well, Ann, you could be a missionary, but you're not going to be a preacher because God don't let women speak in church. But see, that's what she was told, because when she was little, she didn't read. And I'm assuming that's what the preacher told her, because that's what he was told, because we couldn't read back then. We didn't have, we weren't able to read to comprehend what God was talking about. Here we are. God has raised us to this position. We are able to read, and we're able to discern. We're able to get, and God says to get wisdom. That's the principal thing. Get an understanding. So in our understanding, don't understand totally. Don't allow somebody to come by you and say, you know, you ain't supposed to put up no Christmas tree. Huh? And you know what? I have something to say, too, about Santa Claus. You know, when I was coming up, I was told about Santa Claus. I understand the principle that Santa Claus is, you know, they want us to think that Santa Claus is a white man that's giving children toys, little black children toys. And I understand that concept, and I understand how that could be harmful to children if they are not totally understanding the concept about Christmas. It is not about Santa Claus. That's number one. It's not about Santa Claus. Okay? Santa Claus is the parents, and they are all different shades of colors. They're all different shades of colors. I know that Constantine declared that Christmas was on the 25th of December. I understand that that's not the correct date. I understand that too. But we're celebrating the birth of Christ. And no matter what day it is or the date, we're celebrating and being respectful for what Jesus did for us. Because I'm going to always believe in Jesus. I'm going to stand by Jesus till God calls me home. I'm standing with Jesus. That has kept me and my family together. When there was things that I did that was wrong, if I did not always use the scripture, Matthew 6:33, first seek God and his way of doing things, and all things will be added unto you. I sought after me and my emotions and my soulish realm, and I made huge mistakes. So I am saying to you, stick with Matthew 6:33. Ask God to show you how to do things, where to do them things, the things, and when to do them, and who to do them to. So that's a very important scripture on how to get your life back, to stay lined up with the Word of God. But back to the Santa Claus thing. I didn't care as a child whether Santa Claus was black, blue, green, or white. All I wanted was the toys. I didn't care if he came down a chimney or if he knocked on the door. All I cared about was the toys. I didn't idolize Santa Claus, and I didn't idolize the tree. It was the gifts that was under there that I was looking for, that I was expecting. And then when I got grown, I learned how to be a giver of gifts. because God gave the greatest gift of all when he gave Jesus, no matter when the date is that Jesus was born, just that he was born to redeem me from a life of sin. So I'm grateful for that. So don't allow anybody to tell you, not even me, research. The Bible says in 2 Timothy, the 2nd chapter and the 15th verse, study to show yourself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. So if you don't understand, if people are telling you something that maybe just don't sit right with you, don't go with them. Say, no, I'm going to pray about that. I'm going to research that. God's going to tell me where to go. And that's where I'm going to go. I'm going to go and research that. And if in fact that I find that you are correct, I will come back to you and you and I will have a dialogue on what's going on to further explain that particular passage or scripture in the Bible to me. So I'm not going to allow anybody, I don't care who it is, to tell me anything about Jesus didn't exist. He exists for me. He exists in my heart. He exists in my spirit. So I'm not going to let anybody tell me anything different about that. Until you can prove to me that he doesn't, that's what your job has got to be. You got to prove it to me. You got to prove it to me. I'm just not going to listen to you. You shouldn't just listen to me. You should prove me right. Prove me right or prove me wrong. So don't let the misinterpretations that we was given because some people didn't understand, don't allow those misinterpretations to lead you away from God, to not allow you to the real meaning of Christmas, which is the birth of Christ. Jesus is the reason for this season. No matter the date, Jesus is the reason for this season. And there was another misinterpretation, too. We always see the nativity scene where there is Jesus and Mary and Joseph and the shepherd and the animals and the three wise men. Well, in Matthew 2:1-12, it clearly states that when the wise men got to Jesus, he was in a house and he was a child. Read those scriptures because it will tell you that. So there's no way that the wise men was there with Jesus in the manger. No way. Read those scriptures. See for yourself. It says Jesus was a child and he was in a house. So once you start reading those scriptures and you see that people, you know, these doctrines, some of them are false doctrines. Some of them have given you misinformation. And when we have misinformation, we don't make good decisions, including myself. I'm always looking for accurate information. And what I believe and what I can got scripture to back up, I will present to you. Now, I'm not saying I'm going to be right about everything because God knows I am not. What I am saying is that I am striving to be right. I want to be right. But if any time that you feel like I said something that was not right, please inbox me. I have a Facebook page, Valarie Ammons. The Queen's Roundtable have a Facebook page. Inbox me and we will discuss it. I am not above being corrected. I am not above getting more knowledge, and I'm not above to correct myself when I find out that I was wrong. So I'm asking you, if you have some information that you can prove concretely, then please inbox me and we can talk. You can come on the show and we can talk about it. But I'm going to do that research. I'm going to do what I need to do to try to make sure that I'm living righteously. And I don't see us all the time living righteously when we are being misled by women don't speak in church. And then by the wise men getting to Jesus. I mean, demographically, you know, look, they were a long way from Jesus. They were a long way from Jesus. And they were trying to get to, they were on camels in the desert. They're not gonna get to Jesus. They was a long way. away. Jesus was in Bethlehem, and they were where Herod was. So they were a distance away from Jesus. So it took them that long to get to Jesus. Camels don't, you know, they don't go 100 miles an hour. They go very slowly. So it took them a minute to get there. So sometimes things are just plain common sense, and sometimes you can do process of elimination and say, oh, that don't sound right. Now, I know God got all powers. He can do all things, but he also has order and he has balance. And everything God does, he planned it, he prepared it, he structured it to have balance and to have order. Everything that God did. See, before Jesus, there was Moses, okay, and there was Abraham. So they came to build the structure, you know, and then the people then were so evil and mean and not following God till God redeemed us with Jesus. And I am so happy for that gift. And also the wise men, when they got to Jesus, they brought him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Those were gifts that were brought to him. I believe that's where the gift part of Christmas coming, of Christmas was the gift part. So read. The mind is a terrible thing to waste. Don't allow people to throw garbage in there. And then you spit the garbage out to somebody, and then it's a domino effect, forever feeding garbage. Let's go and get accurate information, accurate things that we can bring back to the table and say, this is what I found. This is what I'm going by. And then don't just take two or three scriptures and just go with them. Read the whole book. Read the whole book, like of Isaiah and of the Gospels. Read the book. Just don't say, take one scripture and run with it. Read the whole thing. And then you'll find yourself with much more wisdom and knowledge and understanding of the Word of God and how to live your life. How to live your life. How to worship God, how to serve God, how to please God, and then how to embrace the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding that he will bestow upon you, that he will empower you with. That's what you want to go back out into the community and empower them with, wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. That's what we need now. This world is needing peace. And I speak peace to it right now in the mighty name of Jesus. I speak love and joy and understanding and wisdom to this world, to every man and woman in this world. I speak peace and love and understanding and compassion for your brothers and sisters, and peace be unto you.